Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Alessandro Belluzzo, President of the Italian Chamber of Commerce and Industry for the UK. I'm delighted to be a moderator of this event today. I'm grateful to welcome the Right Honourable Greg Hands, Minister of State for Trade Policy in the Department for International Trade. Thank you very much for your availability. I'm also grateful to welcome the Consul General in Milan and Director of the Department for International Trade in Italy, Caciona Khan. Thank you as well to the British Chamber in Italy for the interest and support, and the relationship between us is always grateful. Each institution, like us, the Italian Embassy and other associations, ASA Lombardia and others, they're always welcome to working together with us and to support our activity together with the Department of International Trade in supporting members and networks, especially in this moment. So in this perspective, we are truly grateful to the Minister and to the DIT for today's opportunity. So I'm pleased now to hand over to the Minister, Greg Hands. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Alessandro, and thank you to everyone for joining us today, to the Italian Chamber of Commerce for organizing this session, and to the members of the British Chamber of Commerce in Italy. As you rightly say, I'm joined by Caciona Graham, our Consul General in Milan, who is also the Director of the Department for International Trade in Italy, our Department for International Trade in Italy, and also by Michael Charlton, who is our Head of Investment here in London. And as I see myself reflected back, I remind myself that I'm in very much in need of a haircut at this time. So if you excuse my appearance, although I'm hearing, if I'm reading correctly, barbers and hairdressers in the UK won't be opening anytime in the next couple of weeks by the sound of things. So it'll get worse before it gets better, I think. But thank you very much indeed for joining. And at this time, all of our thoughts are, of course, dominated by the impact of COVID-19. And in the UK, I'll let you into a secret that my diary secretary is Italian. I think she might be on the line as well, Anna Bevacqua. And she keeps me regularly posted on the situation in Italy. And we've been watching on our TV screens most nights. There's a report from Italy. And really, we've been inspired in the UK by the Italian people for their resilience and solidarity. When I see scenes out of hospitals in Lombardy, in Milan, in Bergamo, and so on, you know, it really was quite a wake-up call for us in the UK as we went into lockdown. And I think great admiration across the UK for everything that Italy has been through so far. Of course, it's not even over yet. But more generally, I mean, I think we value our relationship with Italy very highly. It's the UK's eighth largest trading partner, accounting for about 3.4% of our global trade. And that's about £48 billion sterling in 2019, a 2.1% increase. And that ranges from cars to pharmaceutical products, clothing, to beverages, a huge amount of trade in both goods and services between the two countries. And the UK has actually made it a priority to work closely with Italy and other key allies to coordinate a global response to coronavirus through all the fora that we share, like the G20 and at the WTO, the G7, and other institutions. And I fundamentally believe that looking forward, Italy and the UK have got a lot of similarities, I think, in our approach. We're both sizable economies, which are very dependent on trade. We're very international. We've got some very important key manufacturing sectors, high-end manufacturing in both countries, where access to markets is really important, but equally neither of our countries tries to produce everything. So we end up being dependent also on imports. And I think the lessons of coronavirus will be actually not a return to self-sufficiency or 19th century style autarky, but actually more trade, not less trade, but more diverse trading partners, and making sure that our sources of production are varied and reliable. So I think together the UK and Italy can use our collective voices and capabilities to do everything we can to back the global economy and keep goods and services flowing. And I'm in regular contact with my counterpart in Italy. He's actually my friend, Ivan Scalfarato, working to achieve just that. And he and I can't think of the last thing that we disagreed on, but in all these forums, we work well together. I think turning to business, it's essential that businesses can continue to trade, and we're supporting them to do just that by providing advice, financing, and removing tariffs and barriers. This includes things like engaging with customs authorities to ensure smooth clearance of UK products, providing advice on trade, legal, and intellectual property questions, and reaching out to exporters and investors to understand the challenges they face, not least through calls like this one. We have our own UK world-leading export credit agency, UK Export Finance, working with banks and insurance brokers to back companies which are battling with the disruption caused by coronavirus, whether it be helping them get paid for export contracts, loan schemes, export insurance policy, or direct lending. And it is worth pointing out that this support does not end with UK businesses. There are a range of tools for foreign investors with businesses based in the UK, such as the Business Interruption Loan Scheme, or CBILS as it's called here, and corporate financing facilities as well. Just a little few words about the transition period and the UK's, the ending of the transition period at the end of December. I'd like to briefly address that. Let me be clear, that's not in the responsibility of the Department of International Trade. That rests with Task Force Europe, which reports to the Cabinet Office in the UK. But as you can imagine, our Trade Department has to be keenly aware of the progress of those negotiations and the importance of those negotiations for both our countries and our businesses. But the put simply, the basis of the agreement that we reached in October last year enabled us to leave the European Union on the 31st of January and assume control of our own laws and trade. The question after the transition period expires at the end of this year is whether we can agree with the EU a deeper trading relationship on the lines of the free trade agreement the EU has with Canada, or whether we have a trading relationship based on the 2019 deal on the lines of Australia's. That is the choice that the UK government has laid out. We're not asking for a special, bespoke, or unique deal. We want a relationship with the EU which is based on friendly cooperation between sovereign equals, centered on free trade, which allows us to continue to strengthen trade and investment ties with key partners like Italy. Briefly, a little bit of word on the area directly under my responsibility, the UK's free trade agenda with the rest of the world. You'll have seen that we started our negotiations with the United States. We're in the middle of that first round with the US. We'll be launching shortly negotiations with Japan, followed by Australia, New Zealand, and accession to the CPTPP, the Comprehensive and Progressive TPP as well. So just a final few words. I alluded to this earlier about where trade is going globally in response to coronavirus COVID. Here I think it's incredibly important, particularly to such internationally focused countries like the UK and Italy, very trade and business focused, that we don't lurch back into protectionism. Protectionism and a kind of cry for self-sufficiency and autarky is not going to be the answer. But it's a message that governments really can't deliver alone. You know, it's all very well politicians saying we don't want protectionism, we want free trade. We need all of us to be out there explaining the benefits of free trade, the benefits of the free exchange of goods and services around the world, how our peoples, our consumers, and our businesses benefit from that. And we need to fight those barriers wherever we find them, whether they be short-term barriers on medical goods and medical equipment, or longer-term barriers that get put up as well. So I'd end by urging everybody on this call to be part of the global battle in favor of free trade and against a return to protectionism. We know there are forces out there trying to use the current health emergency to have a call for protectionism and self-sufficiency. We need to resist that whilst recognizing there are areas where both countries would be advised to diversify sources of supply, but that's not the same as saying everybody has to produce everything like we did back in the world before 1914, let's say. So without descending into a historic essay, that's kind of where I see things. A great trade relationship between the two countries. We really value Italian investors, in particular being in the UK, big Italian investments in this country, big UK investments in Italy. And as I mentioned earlier, Michael Charlton, my director of investment, is on the line. Any questions about the investment environment? But also, most importantly, need and desire to promote free trade around the world in all of our different forums. So thank you very much, Dean. And I look forward to any points or any questions that people have. Alessandro, thank you.
Thank you very much for the splendid overview. And I'd like now to invite the participants to submit their questions using the Q&A facilities in this application. Let me say that we have a first question coming from Sir Roccoforte, Chairman of Roccoforte Hotels and our Vice President for the Service Sector. So if I may leave the floor to Roccoforte, please, for the question.
Thank you, Alessandro. Minister, you referred to the discussions and negotiations on Brexit. It would seem to me, although the whole thing is rather drowned by the noise of coronavirus, it would seem to me that the EU is behaving in a pretty intransigent way, and it's trying to retain as much control as what we do in this country after leaving the European Union as it did when we were a member. The likely outcome, the result, is a WTO exit. With the results of the devastation that the coronavirus is causing to the business environment in this country and the need for the country to recover quickly, won't the government want the most flexibility and maneuverability in dealing with this? And therefore, isn't a WTO exit the best outcome?
Yeah, thank you, Rocco, and it's great to see you. I think you're at the first event that I ever came to the Italian Chamber at when I think I was a Conservative Party shadow Treasury spokesperson 11 years or so ago. I can't remember, in one of the major London hotels, and it was great to meet you, I think, for the first time. I've stayed in a couple of your hotels over the years, so thank you very much indeed for joining us today. I'd say two things to that. I agree with you. I agree with a part of your analysis, but I disagree with where you see the outcome coming. I think the EU, I'm not sure intransigence would be the right word, but I think the reality, the political reality in the UK changed on the 12th of December, where now the government has got a majority of 80 MPs. Boris Johnson, and I realise Boris Johnson in Italy is, you know, likely to be somebody who everybody will have an opinion, I would imagine, in Italy of Boris. But Boris is in a fundamentally different position to Theresa May. You know, domestically, Boris is in a very strong position. He's in the strongest position of any British Prime Minister since Tony Blair or Margaret Thatcher. And, you know, I don't think he will be pushed around in the same way that Theresa May's government was. There's not a common person in Theresa May. I think that's what happens in the UK when governments don't have a majority. So I think the EU hasn't yet fully apprised itself of the reality of the position in the UK and still imagining that the common fisheries policy will carry on as before and the UK will be pushed into this, that, or the other. I don't think that's happening at all. But the UK position in the first round of the talks has been pretty resolute. We've been resolute since Boris Johnson's speech in Greenwich in January, laying out the position. You know, the position is, as I said, the UK is seeking a free trade agreement like the agreement Canada has with the EU. If that doesn't happen, we will end up trading with the EU on the terms Australia has. Now, that's the that is the position of the UK government. Where I disagree with you is your analysis that will probably lead to a WTO-style arrangement in the future. And I don't see that, because I still think it's very strongly in both sides' interest to come to a deal and to come to that deal this year. Whatever you think about Brexit in the first place, I don't think anybody can say that the issues are new issues or under-debated issues over the last 4 years now that this debate has been raging. I think the two sides can come to a deal. That is my hope and that is my expectation. It's strongly in both sides' interest to do so, particularly as we recover in the post-coronavirus world, particularly at a time when protectionism is rising across the world. What would it mean if two close trading partners like the European Union and the United Kingdom were unable to come to a free trade agreement? I mean, imagine that at a time when the EU is seeking trade agreements with Australia, New Zealand, Vietnam, and the UK is seeking trade agreements with Australia, New Zealand, Vietnam. And if we were to say, actually, the two sides can't do a trade agreement with each other, you know, I genuinely don't think that's going to happen. I mean, it could happen, but I genuinely personally don't think that is going to happen. I think the two sides will come to a deal, and that deal will take effect on the 1st of January, 2021. So in that sense, I'm an optimist. There's obviously some work to be done, but I don't think it's as if the two sides don't understand what the issues are. It just needs a bit of a spirit of common sense and new realism in Brussels of the political reality in the UK. So I rather agree with you, but I just don't agree with you in terms of the final outcome, Rocco.
Okay.
Thank you very much, Minister. If I may now, we have another question coming from Maurizio Bragagni, CEO of Tratos and our Vice President for the Industry Sector. Maurizio, I leave the floor to you.
Minister, I hope that you can listen me. So
I can hear you well. Yes, thank you, Maurizio.
Thanks, Greg. And thanks a lot for what you have said. We really appreciate, as an international company, the position of the UK government for global business and global trade. And what we have to recognize with the UK government is that is one of the first government that realized, probably for what you have said, that we cannot fight alone COVID-19. So from an international point of view, what is in place from an international trade point of view to combat COVID-19 and in particular to prevent the second wave of infection? And especially now where all other countries have easier lockdown measurement in place.
Yeah, well, thank you, Maurizio. Great question. I'd probably deal with that in two or three ways. So the question, if I said it correctly, so what is the international trade and the UK's international trade response to coronavirus as we've come out of the lockdown? Well, the first thing to say, I think coming out of the lockdown was going to be a really careful balance. The primary concern of the UK government will always be the health of its citizens. And we're always informed by the scientific and medical advice. The reason why the chief medical officer and the chief scientific advisor are very frequently at our daily press conferences is that we follow their advice very closely. Obviously, it's a political judgment and a political call how that advice is followed and implemented. But so coming out of and the recovery, the economy is also incredibly important in this. You know, we have to recognize that it's businesses that pay taxes, that employ people, and it's those taxes that then pay for and provide things like the National Health Service. So you couldn't have the National Health Service without having a strong and resilient economy. And equally, you can't have a strong and resilient economy without a healthy population. So the two things go hand in hand. I think in terms of specific measures, you'll have seen the support that the government has given for businesses during the duration of the crisis, which is still ongoing, in terms of the business interruption loan scheme, in terms of the provision given for companies to pay wages of those who've been furloughed. through to holidays for businesses on business rates and VAT and so on. I mean, huge range of measures. I mean, unthinkable, really, in any normal time for the government to be taking these measures. But we do need to also get the economy moving. And also there, we're adding support in terms of the bounce back loans being provided by the Treasury and making sure there's advice from us, from the Department for International Trade. So we have a network of international trade advisors across the country, more than 300 individual trade advisors. We have expert advice for Italian companies in the UK, led by Michael Charlton on this call and his team, and also by our network in Italy as well. And also we have UK Export Finance, which has, in the run-up to the virus, had greatly increased its credit lines and its ability to finance UK exports around the world, and also the purchase of UK exports in different markets. So UK Export Finance is also there to assist businesses seeking to export. The other thing to mention is we talk a lot to other business groups, so chambers of commerce like yourself, but also the various business representative organisations here in the UK, the CBI, the Federation of Small Businesses, Make UK, etc., etc. So we make sure that at all times we are speaking to businesses and really value the importance of businesses. The UK government's put a lot of effort in making sure that the impact of businesses, impact on businesses, the virus has been not such that businesses have to be in any way be sacrificed. The opposite, you know, we've been supporting businesses. We need to make sure they continue to be supported as we enter into the recovery. So that is why we have a cautious but comprehensive strategy in place. And why we've been very precise in how we will emerge out of the lockdown.
Thank you very much, Minister. another question coming from Alessandro Nervegna, MD of Ferrero UK and our member as well of the Chamber. Alessandro, I leave the floor to you.
Yes, so thanks a lot for the possibility to participate. Thanks a lot to the Minister, very, very good speech. So my name is Alessandro Nervegna. I'm responsible for Ferrero in the UK. We are an international company in the chocolate confectionery market. We have many plants in the world. We have plants, an industrial plant also in the UK, that we are using more and more as an international hub, importing raw material and exporting finished goods. Now, of course, we are a little bit concerned with the current situation, due to the COVID-19. Clearly, the exchange rate is worsening a little versus the euro. We have a big tension on the international markets for the cost of the raw materials, particularly for cocoa, sugar, milk. We may have also some post-Brexit implication and eventually new tariffs. We don't know, but it could be the case. So my question is, how the minister sees the future for the UK food industry at international level in terms of competitiveness? Thank you.
Thank you, Alessandro. Thank you for that. I might ask Michael or Katrina to come in on the specifics on the sector. First of all, I love your product, I have to say. It's quite well eaten in the Hans household, the Ferrero product. So I think two or three things to say. First is, first of all, the level of sterling, which you mentioned. I'm a former UK Treasury Minister, and I was always taught never to comment on the level of sterling as a government minister. Because that's a matter for the Bank of England. I'm aware that relatively weak sterling has been beneficial for UK exporters in most senses, but not if you've got high raw material costs. And as you also pointed out, your raw material costs will also have been rising because global cocoa prices are not denominated in sterling. I think in terms of the UK food sector, the food and drink sector has got a great opportunity with some of these trade agreements. I think the ability to sell into the US market in a preferential way from the UK, and let's be frank, I think the UK is much more likely to come to a trade agreement with the United States than the EU is. I mean, I think we could probably all agree with that. And I think the ability for the UK to get preferential access to the US market for a lot of our high-end food and drink sector, I think is a fantastic opportunity. You know, and that could be anything from Scottish smoked salmon through to Walker's shortbread. I should mention other shortbreads as well. Cheese, you know, Stilton cheese, high-quality cheddar cheese. British lamb. There's currently no British lamb allowed into the US at all. You know, there is a great opportunity for UK food. If we can reduce those tariffs on the Scotch whiskey as well, on UK food and drink. I think in terms of some of the other sector specifics, I might ask if Michael or Katrina had anything to add there, particularly on the chocolate and confectionery sectors, if they're I can't recall. I've spent some time with Michael. I can't recall if he's a confectionery expert. But I'm going to take a punt that he might know more than I do.
Well, he's certainly a confectionery consumer. But I think I'd like the Hans household, the Charlton household, also has lots of Ferrero products. So thank you for that. I think just to add to what the minister has said, two things. The free trade agreements, I think, do genuinely create a significant opportunity for UK-based exporters in both the food and drink sector and beyond. And without betraying any confidences, I was on a call yesterday with a very significant, another very significant food manufacturer in the UK who employed about 5,500 people. And they were making the point to me that they see the UK-US free trade agreement as a mechanism to double their exports. So they currently, 85% of their consumption product is domestic UK and 15% is exported, but currently nothing to the United States. But they have capacity across the 8 plants that they have in the UK to double that, and they believe that the, you know, the skill set of the workforce and the productivity of their plants in the UK would enable that. And kind of based on that example, but many others, the Secretary of State for the Department of International Trade is looking to enable a trade and investment-led recovery out the COVID crisis, and two important component parts of that are obviously enabling larger exports from the UK, but also encouraging foreign direct investment. And the first sector that she's asked us to focus on, other than the broad work we're doing on what those two strategies will look like, is agriculture, food and drink. Partly because of the point the minister makes about the heritage and the quality of British products, but also to encourage more of that those products to be exported. So we're currently in a kind of deep dive exercise to really understand what we can do to encourage greater exports. So Alessandro, offline, would be really interested in talking to you about your thoughts and how we can ensure that the UK's food and drink industry remains competitive, and how we can help companies like yours to export even more than you're already exporting. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Michael. Thank you so much to the Minister. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much for the question again. I'd like now to move for another question from Paolo Formica, MD of SAIPEM UK and member of our chamber. Paolo, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Alessandro, and thank you, Minister, for taking my question. And I have to say thank you very much for your words, especially those in favor of the free trade and against the protectionism. It is our good work to hear at this point in time. So, if you allow me, I would like to have, first of all, SAIPEM is a service energy company. We are based in the area of London and in Aberdeen. In total, we have here in UK about 700 people working for us. And from London, we manage all our activities in the North Sea, Baltic, Arctic Sea. And London is one of the two headquarters for especially the offshore wind industry, which clearly is one of our key markets, especially in the areas. And the reason why it is a key market is even because the UK ambitions in terms of growth in the market and in terms of offshore wind capacity to be installed are impressive. As you know, the offshore wind is a pretty high capital business. A lot of investment upfront are requested. Before the COVID, offshore wind reached more or less what is called the market parity with the fossil fuel sources. It means that producing electricity from offshore wind costs more or less the same as producing electricity from essentially gas. Regardless, still is a sector that needs some government support. Clearly, the lower is the competitive gap against the gas price, the gas electricity, the lower is the magnitude of the government support. Now, one of the consequences of the COVID, as we all know, is the fall of the oil price, which makes the gas more competitive than how it used to be. This is from one side. From the other side, needless to say that COVID impacted to a number of sectors of the business, and therefore, reasonable expectation is that the government might intervene to support more sectors that needed the government support in the past. So based on that, and looking to the future, your ambitions in terms of install offshore wind capacity will remain as they used to be before the COVID, or you believe that they will change and you will not be able to give the same support to install that level of capacity as the industry needs? And second, if generally speaking, the energy policy of the UK will remain aligned to the energy policy of the EU. Thanks very much.
Yes, well, thank you, Paolo. Thank you. Thank you for that. Very, very interesting and good question. And I might bring in again Katrina or Michael. I think Katrina might have wanted to say something on the previous question too, but let me try and deal with it on two fronts. First of all, you're right, the UK has got an amazing recent track record on offshore wind. We have the world's largest offshore wind capacity. I think my figure is still up to date. Michael can correct me if I'm wrong, but I was at the Department of International Trade at its inception in 2016. And until 2018, without sidetracking too far, I resigned from the government over Heathrow Airport expansion. The flight path is directly over my constituency. Well, it's not at the moment, obviously. But one of the things that we did very early on, Michael and I actually, was to make sure that UK government support for offshore wind was very strong. That was making sure there's a regime of support in terms of how we did the contract for difference auctions, and also the kind of sector support, making sure that inward investment came into the sector, which I think was a big success, most typically from European companies. So thank you for your investment into the sector. A couple of other points. I mean, the UK is strongly committed to its net zero requirement. The UK is the first country to pass a climate change law, to put net zero into legislation. That's now more than 10 years ago that we did that. And having net zero by 2050 remains strong UK commitment. It's a pity that the COP26 conference, co-sponsored by our two countries in Glasgow, which was due to take place, I think, this October, has been postponed. But, you know, the political commitment from both the UK and Italy to seeing through the objectives of the Paris Accords and climate change reduction, emissions reduction, I think is a really, really important part of both countries' global diplomacy. I think in terms of where we plan to go from here, that's really probably a question better put to our Department for Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy, BEIS, rather than ourselves. But I might just ask Katrina or Michael if they wanted to add something to that, if they're hearing anything out of BEIS in terms of how the regime will change. And in terms of where the regime will be aligned to, you know, I think the UK will be following a clear independent energy policy. I don't think it'd be right to characterize our energy policy as being aligned to anybody. You know, I think the UK is quite a dynamic player in so many different parts of the energy mix, in oil and gas, in renewables, climate change, and financing. All of these things, I think the UK is a really big player in its own right. But I might just bring in Katrina or Michael if they had anything to add to that, so particularly if you're hearing anything out of BEIS. I doubt if there'd be a change in policy as a result of the virus, but I may have missed something.
Happy to come in here. Thank you for your question, Mr. Formica. This is actually an area very close to my heart. I used to work closely on the offshore wind sector, running the UK's offshore wind investment organisation when we were growing the industry. And you're right, we're very proud to be a leading market for offshore wind and intend to stay in that position. The Minister's outlined the government's clear commitment to net zero. Indeed, as you know, we're one of the first countries to commit to that and to introduce legislation to ensure that we meet those targets. I mean, in terms of it's correct that the policy for this sits with our colleagues in BEIS, who I'm sure you know. But I would say that the economic contribution that offshore wind has made to the UK's industry has been, I know because I've been involved in it, a very important part of the reason why the UK government has supported that industry in the way that we have over the years. And so your company's own contribution, the employment that you're representing, you know, the jobs and growth that we're seeing across the UK as a result of that public investment in clean technology is showing results in terms of growth in the economy. So stories including of companies like yourselves are really important for maintaining that support across government for the future of the industry. I might also add that I'm actually coordinating a new clean growth campaign across the Department for International Trade in Europe. So it's not just that we're looking to continue to grow the industry at home, but offshore wind, of course, represents one of the areas of strength that we're looking to boost our exports in across Europe and indeed the rest of the world. So we're very keen to involve your company in that as well.
Thank you.
I would just add, thank you, Katrina, and I'd just add that you're based in Milan, Katrina, yeah?
That's right, yeah.
And working ordinarily with Andrew Mitchell. One of the decisions we took as a department was to base our centre, our European trade hub, out of Milan. And that's where we put our Her Majesty's Trade Commissioner for Europe. And again, it's a signal of our importance that we give to Italy as a great place to be doing business and locating key UK people as well.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I have another question coming from Roberto Costa, founder of Roberto Costa Group and councillor of our chamber. Roberto, please go ahead.
Good afternoon, and thank you very much for the opportunity, Minister. One of my biggest concerns at this time is the how to recruit the employees. So I would like to ask you, considering the hospitality sector was already affected by the loss of employees due to the Brexit, and for COVID-19, many others have decided to go back to their country, have you considered a strategy to help the hospitality industry to survive?
Yeah, okay, thank you. That's a very good question, Roberto, if I may. Again, I might ask Michael or Katrina to come in on the sector specifics. First of all, I dispute the what you say is people going home back to their home countries due to Brexit or in advance of Brexit. And the most recent statistics that I saw, and maybe a little bit out of date, is, but I don't think so, is that the, for example, the number of EU nationals in the UK remains as high as it was on the day of the referendum. So whereas there may have been EU nationals returning home, I think as many EU nationals have come to the country since the Brexit referendum. You'll be aware that the employment situation in the country before the virus was extremely strong, and I expect that labour shortages probably had more to do with the strong and robust labour situation than due to Brexit. That's my view, and I think that's borne out by the data as well. I think in terms of hospitality is such a vital sector in the UK, and it's going to be, I'll be quite frank, I think it's going to be difficult. It's a sector which has been pretty much completely closed down for the last 6 weeks. So I may have mentioned I'm the constituency member of parliament for Chelsea and Fulham, which is absolutely dependent as an economy on the hospitality sector, and that's major events like the Chelsea Flower Show hasn't happened, through to the location of major major restaurants, major other outlets as well. Some of London's leading places to go to are in my constituency. The close down the hospitality sector since the 20th of March has been very tough. However, I don't think it's as bad as some people in the sector were predicting at that time. I remember back to those days of late March, talking to some of the owners in my constituency of the sector and the operators, and they're all predicting an absolute disaster. And I think the government schemes, the loan schemes, particularly the job retention scheme, the furloughing scheme, have really helped that situation. And we have to be very careful as we emerge from the virus, because again, the hospitality sector is somewhere which by definition, you don't go to places unless you want to talk to people, get close to people, and social distancing requirements is gonna make that very difficult in the hospitality sector. So I think we should not underestimate the size of the challenge, but so far, my belief is the UK government has responded well and responded correctly to supporting the sector. I think in terms of where we go forward from here, I might bring in Michael, might know more about sort of specific plans for the sector. But I think we're all keenly aware, particularly in London, of the importance of the sector to the UK economy, and particularly on the employment side as well. Michael, I don't know if you've got anything to add on hospitality.
Nothing specific, Minister, because it as a sector, it's not really a sector that we're very focused on within the Department for International Trade. However, happy to feed those comments in to colleagues both at the Department for Culture, Media and Sport and our colleagues at BEIS. I guess two other things to mention. Firstly, the department is working very closely with the Mayor of London's office and organisations like London and Partners, and clearly they have an important player in the hospitality industry and the attraction of major events, and so a large component of their membership comes from your sector. So we are having, you know, good dialogue with them in terms of suggestions that they're making. And then secondly, you know, clearly the new immigration system that was introduced prior to the crisis, you know, it's hoped that it's about people, not passports, to enable the right skilled workers to come into the UK to fulfill, you know, job vacancies where those exist. So those are the only additional points I'd add.
Okay.
One point to add perhaps for me, I mean, firstly, I applaud you for what you know, that you've obviously been going through an extremely difficult time. In Italy, you know, we've seen the hospitality industry shut down for even longer, and you know, it really is a credit to them how the you know, the whole resilience of that industry through this difficult time. But it's just the point to make that, of course, Italy is slightly ahead of the UK in terms of the epidemic curve, and also in terms of the date by which the hospitality industry is due to gradually reopen with appropriate guidelines in place. So we're certainly going to be doing a lot of work in reporting how that goes to our colleagues in the UK, and I'm sure your insights as a company as well in that respect will be very useful to hear. But of course we'll see how that goes in June in Italy, and hopefully inform some learning in the UK when we come to that point ourselves.
Thank you, Sandra, very much.
Thank you very much, Sandra. Could I say something here?
Sure, Rocco, sure.
The London depends very much on international travel, and if they're going to be quarantine, people coming into the country going in quarantine, international travel will not start up again. It's unlikely that international travel to any great degree will come back till at least the end of the year, and that means that a lot of London's tourism industry will suffer significantly as a result of that. It's been through the London tourism industry depend winter season where at best it tends to break even and make very little profit. It depends on the summer season to make profit. It will go into another winter season and effectively had three winter seasons in a row, and therefore it will be in dire straits by the end of this year. And in terms of furlough support and so on, I think that the industry should be considered very differently to a lot of others. The other aspect, of course, many of the attractions of London are the events that take place. You yourself refer to the Chelsea Flower Show, Wimbledon, and so on, and the concert halls and museums being able to function properly. And until that takes place again, London will not be an attractive destination for tourism. So what is done with borders is an extremely important factor in all of this.
Yeah, well, thanks, Rocky. If I could briefly answer that, and I don't disagree with any of the points you make. First is, to the best of my knowledge, no decisions have been made relating to international travel. There's been different suggestions that have been out there, but I'm not aware of government decisions yet on that. And I think from our perspective at the Department of International Trade, to do trade, you need people, and you need people to be able to move, to be able to do trade. And I think our perspective will be quite clear on that sort of a question. In terms of events, you're quite right. London is incredibly dependent on events and on the cycle of events, and the, you know, there's a whole calendar that London has established over the last decades of events, and a huge hole is being torn out of that calendar this year, and that may not be the end of it. I think your point about the hospitality industry, given the fact I think we're probably going to be asking the hospitality industry to be subject to special measures for longer than other industries, I think your case that the hospitality industry could be subject to special support, I think that's a suggestion which we will take back to Bays and Treasury. I'm pretty sure that's already under active consideration, that the vital UK hospitality sector is under particular pressure at this time. But I, in principle, I agree with everything you say.
Thank you very much. I'm conscious about time, so I'd like to move forward. We have other three questions. One is coming from Caterina Iodice, is our member of the council as well, of the board. Caterina, can you please do your question? And then we have two questions for the other panelists. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Alessandro, for the opportunity. Minister, thank you very much for sharing your view with us. We need more events like this in these unusual circumstances. I, as a dual qualified lawyer, I assist large Italian large companies and mid-sized and also small companies who trade with UK and invest in UK. And as you know, since the Brexit referendum, Italian business who have been trading with UK and have substantially invested in UK have been suffering from uncertainty. So during this unprecedented time, Anglo-Italian companies who operate within the retail, manufacturing, hospitality and leisure sector in the UK have had further experiencing cash flow difficulties. Following the recent UK Prime Minister announcement, it's likely that those Anglo-Italian businesses will have to carry out additional costs to comply with certain COVID-19 measures before their reopening, regardless of their sites and turnover. As certain businesses are at risk of closure, is the UK government considering to put in place additional financial assistance measures and strategies to support those businesses who have significantly been affected by the pandemic to allow them to go through the additional phases of this pandemic and then Brexit? As you may know, the Italian company have seen the UK as the most favorite destination. So the country all around the world are also very attractive. They want to attract investments. Therefore, what are the strategies that UK are putting in place in order to maintain this position against the Italian companies investing in UK?
Thank you, Caterina. I'm wondering, Alessandro, if I could take all three questions at once, because
yes, of course. I'm
to finish this at five.
Sure. There's a question coming from the line, Biwaga, if Canada deal is not achieved by December 2020, will be there an extension? And the other question, what about the future of the real estate in London, specifically? And that's it. That's the other.
Okay, thank you, Sandra. Well,
I know Maurizio Bragani has to leave. I want to say bye-bye, Maurizio. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Maurizio. Thank you. Just a few things. I think that the first question from Caterina and the second question are linked. And I think Brexit uncertainty, look, I think the best way of giving certainty is to repeat that the UK, the transition period will be ending on the 31st of December. The UK will not be seeking an extension. If the EU offers an extension, the UK will not agree to it and will not be itself asking for an extension. I think that's the best way to create the certainty, is for people to know that the process that started on the 23rd of June 2016 will be over and the UK will have both left the European Union and left the transition period. We do think it is quite perfectly acceptable for the UK to leave with a Canada-style free trade agreement. You know, it's something that the EU has agreed to before. We're not asking for a special consideration. We're not asking for a bespoke deal. We're asking for something that the EU has already granted to Canada and a similar agreement with Japan. We think what we're asking for is a perfectly reasonable thing for a sovereign country to be asking. So, and I think that is the best way to end any uncertainty. I think in terms of extending and other business support, Treasury and the BEIS, our business department, are reviewing all of these schemes on a continuous basis. The Chancellor of the Exchequer announced today the extension of the job retention scheme, the furlough scheme, and I think it's only right that we sort of see how existing schemes are working out. There are already massive government support schemes in place. I think it's only reasonable we see how those schemes work before pledging more support. But I think, you know, you can see the importance to the UK of keeping its citizens healthy and its businesses healthy as well. And those things are under continual assessment. And finally, the future of real estate in London is certainly well outside of my brief. But, you know, my constituency is one of the most expensive places in the UK to buy real estate. It's not government policy to encourage higher real estate prices, nor necessarily to encourage foreign investment in real estate in central London. The sector has been doing well enough on its own. It would be difficult for me to speculate on the future of the sector, but it has survived quite a few crises and has been in robust health more or less the last 30 years or so. But my position as Department of International Trade, I've got no specific comment on London real estate. But can I end, Alessandro, by just thanking you and all of your members, an excellent set of questions. I've really enjoyed doing this. If it's okay, I'll put out a tweet afterwards as well on Twitter saying really enjoyed my session with the Italian Chamber. Really good question and answer session. And a thanks also for Italian investment in the UK and our strong trading links and working together as we leave the crisis.
Thank you very much, Minister. And thank you for the active questions and answer. I think that we do more of this kind of events, and it's been really appreciated having also colleagues from Italy and everyone else join us. And we very much look forward to continue our collaboration. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you. I'll happily do another one of these later in the year as well.
Thank you.
Very good. Thank you very much, Minister.
Excellent. Thank you, Rocco.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you, Alessandro.
Thank you, Fiona. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone.
Thank you, Alessandro, for leading us through that. Really fantastic.
Pleasure.
Thank you very much.
Thanks. Thank you. Bye.